What up, players? It's Warboss Tay up in his mug. Welcome to my part one of this video series, How to Paint a House Lannister Bowman. So the colors you're going to need are Dryad Bark, Steel Legion Drab, Doombull Brown. I believe I primed this guy in black to begin with also. Corn Red, so if you have a black primer handy, or a gray primer handy, that will be most like this tutorial. For silver, we're using Lead Belcher, of course. Averlyn Sunset for the yellows. Bugman's Glow for all the flesh. Rackarth Flesh. XV88. Mournfang Brown. Balthazar Gold. And that is it for the main colors. You can see that just before filming this clip, I also put the shades on. Ooh. Sorry, my autofocus is acting up a bunch too, so if it does that, just close your eyes for a second while it readjusts. Sorry, I'm still getting used to the f-stop and then ISO and all that other stuff in this camera. Raiklin Flesh Shade. I do have another lens. Maybe I'll try with the other lens and see if it's better at doing these close-up videos. Okay, so what I did first was I primed the model in black, and I decided that I wanted to have more of a neutral tone to work with. So I used this Steel Legion Drab, and I just painted the whole thing Steel Legion Drab. I let that dry for a while, and then I came back with XV88. Now, of course, the XV88, I'm going to keep kind of similar to the House Stark Bowman and make this the color of the bow. Just because it's a nice, rich, goldeny brown. It should pop pretty nicely. It'll make a good color to work off of. And if you haven't been keeping up, what I'm doing is I'm painting a battalion of Bretonians for Warhammer Fantasy, but I'm using the Game of Thrones color schemes and the Game of Thrones fluff and fiction for all of them. But this isn't going to be one specific force. What I'm going to do is try to paint all the different houses from the book, because I remember when I was reading Game of Thrones, I thought, oh, it would be great to see these guys on a tabletop. And with the Bretonians being pretty close to what I imagine the Game of Thrones miniatures would look like. Of course, it's going to have a lot of differences. Doombull Brown is what we're going to use to paint the leather. But I thought, you know, Bretonians would be fun. Plus, you've got a lot of iconography in the transfers that we can use to represent the different houses from Game of Thrones. I was looking at the Bretonian transfer sheet, and a lot of them look like they were pulled from or influenced pretty heavily by Game of Thrones. Like, you've got the two towers, the castle one, that kind of looks like it could represent the twins or the house of Walder Frey. They don't have a wolf, but we do have Space Wolves transfers, which is, I think, pretty awesome if you want to do a House Stark force. I think I mentioned this in another video, but there's a book out that has the iconography of all the lesser houses of Game of Thrones, Song of Ice and Fire. And so I'm going to see if I can pick that up from my local gaming store the next time I go down. It's got history, fluff, fiction, stats if you're interested in playing the role-playing game, which I heard didn't do too well when it first came out, but maybe there will be a resurgence one day. But yeah, it has all of the heraldry for all of the lesser houses, along with all the colors. And a lot of them are different than what you might think. I think I was looking at the Lannister page when I walked into the hobby store and I found it. And the House Lannister, the supporting the bannermen, the minor houses that support House Lannister. Some of them are very, very colorful. You got greens and whites, and very different because House Lannister, as you know, as we move on to Khorne Red to color the jerkin. House Lannister is very predominantly red with gold or yellow, and that's just to symbolize how rich they are, the red and the gold. The red and yellow is also a very prominent color scheme for Bretonians in, oh, I forget which house it was called, but the nobles of one faction use it, but I think it's like a red dragon on a yellow field is the iconography. But for our purposes, we're going to do a yellow lion on a red field, or a red lion on a yellow field. So the Khorne Red that I'm using, I think it's already down to its last legs. Also, I'm going to need to get a new pot of Khorne Red because it's pretty watery. I didn't dip my brush into the pot, so naturally when I put it on the wet palette, it got even more thinned down, the pigment spread out even more. I'm going to have to go back and get another pot. Okay, Averlyn Sunset. When I was deciding to do this Bretonian project, I thought, you know, I don't want to go too bright with the colors because then it'll look almost exactly like Bretonians. I want to keep it kind of drab and dark with only some spot colors just to kind of match the HBO series, Game of Thrones. But I think in the end, I'm going to go with a little bit more pop, a little bit more color. When I can. Like House Lannister, obviously, if any house would have some color, it would be House Lannister or some of the richer houses. The ones in the more temperate and warmer climates. So the Averlyn Sunset is going to just be used to paint the I don't know what that's called, the little neck napkin. If I was using a head with a hood, I would also use the yellow for the hood as well. I decided to go with this face and yet use the Lannister color scheme because I thought, you know, at some point you're going to have to use some heads or pieces that might not fit the fluff of your army. In this case, the Lannisters are known to be a very rich family. They're known to have lots of money to equip and outfit their troops. So you would have very, you know, handsome, attractive, clean, well-equipped looking troops. But then you've got these peasant bowmen, and especially this one head in particular. It's the Bretonian bowman head with the bandage wrapped around his face. So I decided to just make it a part of the figure's narrative that this bowman, who has served loyally for years and years, was in a fight or a battle, maybe one of the battles to against the Mad King in the history, one of Robert's battles, Robert the Usurper, and in one of the battles he got his nose chopped off. Dryad bark is being used now to paint the shoes. I think with these characters you can, or this sculpt specifically, because there's no tears in the stocking, you could use either, I use, you know, brown leggings, or the color Steel Legion Drab to represent that he's wearing brown leggings, or you could paint up the legs as if he wasn't wearing stockings in a fleshy color. So I think I'm just going back now and I'm double checking that all the colors are in line. Mournfang Brown is going to be the next color that we use to paint the leather bracer on his left hand. You'll see though that I'm, at some point I'm going to the video is going to skip ahead. I'm going to cut the camera off and let the figure dry for a little while, and then come back and clean some of the mistakes that I made. And I suggest that you do the same as well. Try not to sit or get through a figure in just one sitting, because you can make lots of mistakes, especially if the paint is still wet. Bugman's Glow now for the skin. It's tempting to just, you know, barrel through. And you can do that if you're doing assembly line style painting with a whole squad or a unit. But I would say try to avoid that if you're doing single fingers. Single figures. Yeah, this source book, though, I was reading for the Song of Ice and Fire role-playing game. I think at the beginning it had some really interesting notes about Westeros and their culture, like the kind of food they eat, and the shields, colors, banners, the heraldry in general, how to make it, how it was placed on the soldiers and stuff. So I think it'll be an interesting read, and I think it was just this one role-playing game's, the one company's, you know, take on it, but I think it's still going to be an interesting little source book, just like Sigmar's Heirs or the Uniforms and Heraldry of the Empire for Warhammer Fantasy. Okay, Rakarth Flesh is going to be used to paint all the bandages, specifically, or the wrappings. Specifically, what I mean is the bandage around this guy's face and the wrapping around the grip of the bow. Once the paint has dried, I'm also going to be using it in a little bit to paint the stitches for his patchwork shirt. You'll notice that his shirt has a little bit of a patch on it right by the left arm, so I'm going to be repainting that in a different color and using Rakarth Flesh as the stitching, but for now we're just going to use it to paint the bandage around this guy's face to hide his horrific, horrible disfigurement from his battle wound. This is one of those times when you're going to want to brace your hand against something, like I'm bracing it against a piece of cork, and that'll give me a smooth and easier, non-shaky time when getting to the bandage. Okay, XV88. It's the same color that we used on the bow, we're gonna use on this guy's hair. It's gonna be the base for his kind of dirty blonde hair that we're gonna be highlighting up as we go on. So you can make some pretty interesting narratives while I'm painting this guy. I thought to myself, oh, his story could be that he's, you know, the Lannisters are known for being very attractive, handsome, and good-looking people, and so maybe this is a Lannister trooper that is very ashamed and horrified of his disfigurement, and he's kind of let it rule his life. The lead belcher is, again, it's just going to be used for the caps on the bow, as well as his belt buckle. Sorry, the camera keeps going out of focus, depending on where I put the model. Rakarth Flesh, again. I think we're going to try to get it on the wrapping of the bow grip here. So again, because the bows are shaped in such a way, with four sides rather than being a very smooth and rounded bow, you get to really paint each side to your satisfaction before you adjust the model and paint the new side. So you want to just make sure that you look at it from different angles, turn the model in your hand or on the piece of cork or whatever that you're using, and just make sure that you don't have to come back to a side. Okay, what I was thinking of doing next is, you can see I'm taking the Lead Belcher Silver and I'm just coloring the buckle now, and I'm also coloring the little silver hooks or whatever you want to call it that are connecting the iconography to his uniform. Okay, back to Averland Sunset now. And I'm just basically going over the same area around the collar that I went over before. And I'm also painting in the little stitches in the front. Having a minimum color palette, using yellow instead of like a completely different color like purple or orange, it helps for the eye to kind of tie in the model when you look at it from at first glance or from far away. If I'd use like a crazy out there totally different color than like bright blue or something, then it would be pretty jarring. So especially with these rank and file models, it's good to have as much detail as you want to put the time and invest the effort into doing, but to help you, so you don't have to worry too much about the overall finished appearance, try to use a minimum number of colors, or keep the colors in the same neighborhood, like all of the browns, Mournfang Brown, Steel Legion Brown, Steel Legion Drab, rather, Doom Bull Brown, they all kind of make the figure blend into that have a kind of consistent brown coloring to it. It's the same kind of grouping that you do if you're doing like a wood elf theme to a specific season. As you can see, I'm using Balthazar Gold to paint some of the icons and pendants. Ritonians, just like Empire, have a lot of little charms and fetishes on a lot of their models, so since the Lannisters do love their gold, we're going to paint a lot of gold on him. Alright, now we're going to move on to the final part of the video, Agrax Earthshade Wash. Just going to go on just about everything, except we're going to try to get it off, keep it off the skin and the hair and the his little bib that he's wearing, but everything else we're going to try to get right in there. And you want to make sure when you're using Agrax Earthshade, if you've not heard this before, then this might be a valuable tip. Make sure you shake up your pot so that the pigment kind of gets all mixed up, because otherwise it separates and then you've got just this really oily, greasy film on the top of the pot that isn't really going to do anything for you. You want to mix in that great brown color into it. Okay, we're getting it on just about everything, like I said. Agrax Earthshade will really deepen that red and make it a lot darker. Okay, we're going all the way around. And around the bandage on the head. And then all the nooks and crannies, like that little crook right by the elbow there. Okay, moving on to the Seraphim Sepia now for the yellow areas. Seraphim Sepia, or any kind of sepia shade or wash, is a great color to tone down the brightness of a yellow and also give it really nice natural shading. And it's also going to be used here for its hair. So we want to spread the wash around, make sure it doesn't pool and leave any unsightly puddles. So we're just going back over the entire model now before we finish with the Raequin Flesh Shade. So just taking a look at now at our model and seeing what we can do before we add on the final shade, which is Raequin Flesh Shade, to shade down the skin. Again, all of these techniques can be used with any figure. This was just the one that I decided to build up, but feel free to use these colors and techniques with any of your Bowman figures if you're going to be trying to recreate a Lannister color scheme. And thanks for watching! You can visit me on my website at warbosstaystudios.com to commission me for a project yourself, and follow me here on YouTube as well as everywhere else. Reach me at warbosstaystudios@gmail.com, and we'll see you in the next video. Laters!